You are about to listen to the Dr. Daliah Show. Sassy, stimulating medical talk radio. Any medical advice Dr. Daliah Wax gives on her show should not be substituted for an actual visit to your medical provider. And now, here's Dr. Daliah.
Doctor, doctor, give me the news. I got a bad case of loving you.
All right, we are back on the Dr. Daliah Show. 1-877-DOCDALIAH. 1-877-DOCDALIAH. So I have heard a few times, and I just saw another article, where Gen X is part to blame, or being considered part to blame, for what's been happening in today's society. And my answer to that is, excuse me, say what? No, I'm a Gen X. Don't be blaming all this BS, this college campus BS, our national security issues, our economy, our, don't be blaming that on Gen X. But they are. Now, why? Why would anybody decide to mess with us Gen Xers? Gen Xers, I think, are one of the coolest. We're cool. We did nothing wrong. We actually, I think we did pretty darn good. But why are Gen Xers now being the focus? First of all, who are the Gen Xers? So Gen Xers are those who were born between 1965 and 1980. Baby boomers were 45 to 65, roughly. Although I know a lot of baby boomers who say, you know, if they were born when, you know, daddy came home on leave, some people, even though they're called traditionalists, if you were born before 45, I am fine with, if you think you are a, you know, wartime on leave baby, that's fine. If you want to be called a baby boomer, I'm fine with that. But anyway, baby boomers up until the 65, Gen X is 65 to 80, millennials roughly 80 to 95, Gen Z's 95 to 2010, Generation Alpha 2010 to 2025. And if they don't come up with a better name for Generation Alpha, Generation Beta is going to be 2025 on up. So roughly it's like a 15-year period. So us Gen Xers, 65 to 80, most of us grew up in the 80s, 70s, 80s. We were young adults in the 90s. And that's when we started to vote. And Gen X was the generation that might have put more attention on college. Gen X was probably one of the first generations to be less enthusiastic about joining the military, which I don't think was a good thing, but it was easier to go to school. There were much more campuses, much more opportunities, student loans. So many people in the Gen X generation said, I don't have to go through the military to get college. I can work, do other things. Gen X's seem to be very supportive of us moving towards tech and getting computers and AI out there. With all the movies and stuff we saw in the 80s and 90s, we wanted facts. We wanted computer. We wanted internet. We wanted email. And we were the primary consumers and pushed it. Generation X was also one of the generations to maybe slow down on some of the old corporal parenting punishing styles. So many Gen X's weren't really into the belts and the beating and the other stuff. Gen X was like, you know what? We're going to do timeout. We're going to do positive parenting. Gen X was also of the generation that looked a little differently at divorce, as opposed to baby boomers that were like, you know, divorce still might be taboo. You know, Gen X's were a lot more open to divorce. Gen X, however, was a lot more conservative from sex standpoint. Because of HIV and AIDS, many of us were the condom generation. But with that also, Generation X, I think, had fewer babies. Generation X was one of the generations to not necessarily embrace where we have to have a super big family. Now this is on the whole. You had a lot of people who are Gen X's that still had six kids. Good for you guys. Well, it's wonderful. But on the, for most of it, Gen X's we had a lot more women going to college. Gen X's had a lot more females in careers. And so Gen X's had fewer babies. I only had two children, much different than my mom, who had four. So we, you know, so if somebody is trying to say that where we are today is because of Gen X, and it's saying, well, because of our pushing and drive for tech, for our fewer babies to be able to help support the older generations, the less disciplined, and they're trying to say that Gen X has now been the watershed generation to allow millennials and Gen Zs to say, to hell with marriage, to hell with commitment, you know, let's just all do tech, you know, forget about joining the military. Why would we do that? And, you know, I wouldn't blame Gen X for things like that. I know people want to blame somebody. I just think society changed. You know, when you can now meet people online for free, and it's a lot cheap. When you have individuals who are like, you don't have to take me out on a date and court me and marry me. I'll have sex with you. Yeah, things are going to change. That's not Gen X's fault. You know, when you change the way, you're approaching, you know, national security and, you know, people are seeing what happens when, our amazing men and women are overseas and suffer such horrible atrocities, the younger generation sees that. So they're less likely to want to be a wounded warrior or need care or need those houses that those charities are offering. And so tech and the way we've done media and all that has changed people's view in terms of traveling. Now you could see Italy, and you could watch a bald eagle and their baby eggs, you know, in a nest. You don't have to necessarily trek to that. Now, millennials and Gen Z still like to camp. They still like to serve their country. They still like to do things. But yeah, you know, but just because things changed, you know, with our generation, doesn't necessarily mean that you could blame some of the stuff that's going on us. But it is interesting to see what each generation did in terms of contributions. And we contributed some really damn good music. 1-877-DOC-DOLLY, don't go away.
Let's see, if something costs less, but people are happier with it, that sounds like something to look into, and that's MediShare. Maybe you've heard switching to MediShare to pay for healthcare can save the typical family $500 a month, and that's huge, but it's also true that people are way more satisfied after making the switch, too. The customer satisfaction rate for MediShare is double that of the typical health insurance plan. Double. MediShare works. It's been around for more than a quarter century, and members have shared more than $3 billion of each other's bills. People love having telehealth and a huge nationwide PPO network. So, yeah, you can save a ton and like it better. Imagine being happy with how you're taking care of your health care. So if you're self-employed or part of the gig economy, or you just want a plan you're happy with, you can call right now and get a price within 2 minutes. A very, very smart use of 2 minutes. Here's the number you need. 855-SHARE-40. That's 855-SHARE-40. 855-SHARE-40.
Hey, guys, it's Dr. Daliah. Fantasy football season is coming, but sadly, too many of you are taking the bench while the country takes part in one of the most exciting and lucrative industries out there. Don't know how to play? Well, huddle up and listen. Paul Kalikas and I have written a fantasy football pocket guide for beginners. This book walks you through the basics and shows you how simple and lucrative joining or creating a fantasy football team can be. Read our fantasy football pocket guide for beginners found on Amazon or follow the links on X and Facebook. That's fantasy football pocket guides for beginners. Don't be left out.
In a study, it was found that 33% of 44 herbal supplements had no trace of the advertised herb. Don't let that happen to you. Hi, this is Dr. Mitch. If you want to ensure quality, please go to TotalWellness.com. Supplements made for physicians only now available to you too. TotalWellness.com, helping you to look good, feel good, and enjoy total wellness.
All right. right. We are back on the Dr. Daliah Show. Thank you all for tuning in. 1-877-DOC-DALIAH. 1-877-DOCDALI. Big thanks to Talk Media Network for making the show happen. Big thanks to Daniel, our producer. And big thanks to y'all for tuning in. We really do appreciate it. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter or X at Dr. Daliah and on Facebook, the Dr. Daliah Show. So healthcare costs, according to Fox News, are up 300% higher if you are privately insured than if you have Medicare. Now, I know people who are privately insured have more medical costs. That's, you know, but 300% higher? So this report, they say most Americans, more than 65%, have private health insurance. But this new report says there's a potentially very expensive drawback. If you have private coverage, you may end up paying much more for your medical care compared to those who have public health insurance. Now, this is according to recent data from Rand Corp. So if you have Medicare, you may be paying less than if you have private insurance. Why? Well, they say as of 2022, employers and private insurance companies paid an average 254% more for medical services than what Medicare programs would have paid. Several states, California, Florida, Georgia, New York, South Carolina, West Virginia, Wisconsin, had medical costs that were more than 300% higher than Medicare prices. The researchers analyzed medical claims data from a large population of privately insured patients who were treated at 4,000 hospitals between 2020 and 2022. And they looked at the overall relative prices. They said it's never been done before because it's so difficult to collect the data and to get permissions to publish the hospital and health system names associated with each relative price. But it's price transparency. And they said naming the hospitals and presenting their overall relative prices is, you know, hasn't been done before. They said the report gives employers a tool they can use to become better informed purchasers of healthcare services. Hospitals account for the largest share of healthcare spending in the U.S., so this report also provides valuable information that may aid policymakers interested in curbing healthcare costs. So, you know, just because some place charges more doesn't mean necessarily you're getting higher quality. But they say hospitals bill private insurers multiples of the Medicare allowable. The elevated costs, they say, are passed on to patients, resulting in higher premiums and out-of-pocket expenses. So how is this happening? Now, as a physician, okay, if Medicare only paid me, let's say, $40 for a physical. They used to not pay for physicals. Let's say I got $40. I usually would get less to the same from a private insurer. Private insurers are going to take what Medicare pays and use that as a barometer. They're not going to pay more if they don't have to. Now, on some things, they might pay more. Doctors can't live on what Medicare pays. Medicare would sometimes not pay. They said, yeah, I know you did a urine, but we're not paying. Or I know you gave the flu shot, but we're only going to give you 12 cents for the flu shot. Well, that's why a lot of doctors stop taking Medicare, because they're like, Medicare is not paying. And so some insurance companies would actually reimburse you. The average flu shot costs about maybe $8 to $10 a person. When you look at the shot, the syringe, alcohol, the time, the nursing, you know, so you average, so if you break even, if that. Usually you lose money on giving flu shots. But, you know, I can understand why some private insurers are saying, look, Medicare is screwing you over. We're not going to do that. In fact, there was a doctor office who had to pay Medicare tens of thousands of dollars back because they were doing stress tests. And you bill for, you know, the treadmill test, you bill for the read, you might bill for the telemetry. There's certain services you do. Medicare decides after the fact, according to this one doctor's office, to say, you know what, we're not going to cover that other piece. It's just going to be bundled. So now you have to pay it back. Well, So, of course, Medicare's paying less, especially if they're asking for money back. Medicare asked me for money back. I was doing urine tests like I normally do in the office. And there's the urine test and your cost of the test strip and measuring it. And then there's the cost of you sending it to the lab and packaging it up for the lab. And then reading the results. They decided that they're not going to pay for any of that. And they asked for the money back, or they just took it for all the urine tests we did. Not that the urine tests were not, you do a urine test on your high blood pressure patient. You do it on your diabetic patient. They were all valid urine tests, but they just decided they wanted the money back. Thank God for me, it didn't end up being tens of thousands of dollars because I don't charge that much to do a urine test. But those were some of the tricks Medicare was doing. So a lot of doctors don't take Medicare. Me, I just closed my office. That was easier. But some hospitals charge less than, you know, Medicare. Some charge a little more. Now, why? Why wouldn't they just do what Medicare does? Well, because again, if Medicare's only paying you 12 cents for the shot, it's you need to then make up for what Medicare is not paying. And with the way the system works, which is a complete mess up, is we're going to charge X amount. Let them write it off. Let them say no, because that's what insurance companies do. If an insurance company only wants to pay me $2.42, it doesn't matter if I charge $100, $150. They're only going to pay me $2.42. There's a company in Nevada that's notorious for that. Patient pays $30 copay. They'll only pay $2.42. So it doesn't matter if I charge $100, $1,000. I'm only getting $2.42. But one time, my biller came to me saying, Daliah, you're undercharging for the urine test. I'm like, why? What are you talking about? Well, you charged $8 and they only gave $8, but this insurance company will give you $10 every time you run a urine test. And I go, well, what do you do? She goes, well, you charge $12 or $15. Then they'll write it down and you'll never get underpaid. So that's how doctors and companies approach it. They'd rather overcharge and let the insurance just write it off like they usually do and say, this is all you're getting, than to undercharge and lose out on money. It's a real stupid system. So then now you're a cash patient and you're paying on that $1,000 visit or that $100 urine test. Me, I just charge $15 for the urine. But still, and then luckily with our office, we did cash discounts across the board. You know, but for people who go to a hospital, if their insurance says we're not paying, now they're stuck with a $15,000 bill when they were just in the ER for an hour. So we do have to have a better system. But the reason why these prices are happening is because hospitals are getting screwed. These hospitals along the border where migrants with no insurance are coming and using services, those hospitals need to stay alive by paying people. So they have to make it up on the back end. So when you hear these hospitals are charging an arm and a leg, one of the reasons why that might be happening is because they usually get zero. They take it in the pants on most patients who don't pay. So if they do get an insurer that'll pay, that gives them some breathing room to cover the patients that don't pay. It's a horrible system. Everybody needs to pay. Prices need to be lower. Care needs to be transparent. Don't be giving me stuff I don't want or I don't need. Don't be running tests just to save your malpractice butt. If you really think the test is going to save my life, great. But if you're doing the test because you're going to get sued if you miss something, I need to have a choice. And if I don't want it, let me sign something so you don't get sued. We really have to revamp all of this. But hospitals get sued. If an ER doctor misses a stroke, misses a heart attack, misses a tumor, they're in trouble. So yeah, they are going to do the test needed so they don't miss it. So in order for us to lower these costs, we need to get the lawyers involved, who'll sue less. We need to get the patients involved so that they understand why the tests are being done and what needs to be done. We also have to understand that we have people using our services for free. And if we do not have the money to treat them for free, We may have to limit some of the numbers coming in. Until we could figure out a plan to give migrants free medical care, we need to probably slow down the migrants coming. When we have individuals in cities who have absolutely no plan on paying their bills, they'll get their nails done. They'll get a new iPhone, but they won't pay the doctor bill. But what do? If people don't pay bills, the people that do pay the bills are the ones paying. 1-877-DOC-DALIAH. Guys, Dr. Daliah here. Addictions can sneak up on us and come in many forms, whether it's drugs, alcohol, sex, video games, porn, or something less obvious such as food, internet, or shopping. Addiction can seem innocent at first and then evolve into an insurmountable evil. In our book, Addiction Basics, Caitlin Kalikas and I dive into the common addictions and provide tips for identifying and preventing these before they sneak in and take over our lives. Addiction Basics can be found on Amazon or my website, drdaliah.com. Check it out.
Carl Amari here to tell you about our newest website for old-time radio lovers. It's 100radioshows.com. At this site, there are 5 old-time radio shows waiting for you to download free as our gift to you. And be sure to browse the additional 700 old-time radio shows available to you for 70% off by using the promo code radio at checkout. This is a limited-time offer, so log on to 100radioshows.com. That's 100radioshows.com.
All right, we are back on the Dr. Daliah Show, 1-877-DOC-DALIAH, 1-877-DOC-DALIAH. So this is interesting. All right, Harrison Butker, right, I think Kansas City Chiefs, was giving, I believe, a commencement speech at a Catholic private liberal arts college in Kansas. And in this 20-minute speech, he advocated, you know, the benefits of being a homemaker and said that his wife Isabel's life, quote, truly started when she began living her vocation as a wife and a mother. And so when people heard him talk about this and seem to promote and support being a homemaker, people have asked for him to be removed from the NFL. There's a change.org petition entitled Demand the Kansas City Chief to Dismiss Harrison Butker for Discriminatory Remarks. Now, Whoopi Goldberg has come to his aid, Whoopi Goldberg on The View, saying that he shouldn't lose his job because he's a staunch Catholic. I believe he's Catholic. I don't know what his religion is. But, you know, the NFL, I guess, released a statement saying that Butker gave his speech in his personal capacity. The NFL does not share his views. So I believe the NFL does. And everybody starts to panic. And, you know, why can't somebody talk about being a homemaker? Now, I get seeing a man, you know, suggest women should be homemakers might not necessarily be the best optic. But I have said this time and time again. We, from a progressive standpoint, have been so supportive of women in jobs, women in roles, women as president, women as vice president, that we are almost demeaning and extinguishing and canceling those women who are doing the most important job on this planet, raising kids, homeschooling, unifying the family. And so, you know, I've always been a career woman. And thank God my husband was there for the kids when I couldn't be. Because when you hold a medical office, the patients come first. You don't want the patients to come first above your kids, but they do. And if those patients are taking a long time and they're not leaving and you're there late or they need callbacks, if you're a doctor that wants to give the best care, you do that. The phone would be ringing in the middle of the night from the answering service with people having questions, wanting their free medication refills all over the phone. And my kids had to suffer as a result of that. And so if I could have done it differently, would I have? Well, I would have never left medicine. I'm glad I did what I did. But, you know, there are days where I'm like, I probably should have given my kids more time, not dragged my kids to work, made them, give them a different sort of home life. And so as a woman who works, knowing that there are women who are homemakers, every time I meet one or have a patient who's one, I say, God bless you. Society has made it seem like somebody who stays at home and doesn't have a career is lazy. Are you kidding me? I mean, I told my husband, if I had to stay home and work and clean and teach and tutor and do, I couldn't do it. It's easier for me to go to work. And so I think for some, I mean, my mom doing what she did, it's amazing. She raised 4 kids. Not easy. And so when you have somebody who, is telling young college students that it is that his wife found amazing purpose being there for the family, that shouldn't be hidden. That shouldn't be canceled. Now, I don't know if he made any other comments that might have been conservative and ticked off the liberal college. I don't know. I guess some people are saying that he also had brought up abortion and Pride Month. And so I'm not exactly sure what all the controversy is, but a big part of it is centered around him advocating homemaking as a vocation. I'm fine with that. If a dad wants to be home with the kids, look at how now we have parental leave for mom or dad. Absolutely, the child should have access to their dad. We really try to diminish, having a woman vice president, it's very cool. I just wish we had a better representative. But, in Kamala Harris's defense, they rarely let the vice president show up the president. I mean, I don't know if this is her or just the situation, but if you made me border czar, I would be on a flight to the border that day, or I'd start driving down. I would be like, I'm on it. I would leave the Oval Office saying thank you, and I would start that. I would get to the border. I would meet with everybody who I needed to. Go, guys, what do you need? You tell me what you need, and I'll make it happen. There's no way that let a vice president do that, especially if it's opposite what Biden wants. So, in her defense, but, I just don't really see her. I think we could have had better, vice presidential candidates, which is why I also think it's a mistake to say, I am only going to choose a woman as my vice president. Biden should have said, I'm going to choose the best person for the vice presidency office, because they may replace me later after my 2 terms. I want you guys to have the best person. And then if it ends up being a female, great. But once you say, you know what, we are going to dissect out only those females and throw away all the other applications so we only have a focus and no other distractions on this small pile of applications, that's insulting to women. But my biggest regret in life is I wasn't more of a homemaker. I mean, there is so much I could have taught my kids that I haven't, because they didn't go into medicine. Yeah, I taught them a lot of medicine. I taught them how to run an office, but that's not what they're going into. I should have taught them how to cook. I should have taught them how to sew. I should have taught them how to clean. I should have taught them how to take care of the pets. I should have taught them how to reorganize things, how to time manage, how to tutor, there's so many other things I could have done that I didn't. And so, it's interesting when somebody has an opinion You know, and they're Catholic, or they're Muslim, or they're Jewish, or they're Mormon, or they're, everybody is so quick to cancel them. You're allowed to have an opinion. You're allowed to be a liberal. You're allowed to be a conservative. You're allowed to be a stockbroker. I mean, the way a stockbroker thinks might be a lot differently than somebody else who manages money more conservatively. You're allowed to have differing opinions. An internist may differ from a family doctor on how to approach care. It is okay. If we all think the same, this isn't a free country. It'll be very creepy if we all think the same. If somebody feels that a fetus is alive, baby, who has a chance to live and be one of us because we were all fetuses, that's fine. Let them. If somebody feels a woman should be able to terminate that and, you know, without there being a reason, that's their opinion. Everybody has opinions. We have to make sure we don't break laws. We have to make sure we give rights and preserve those rights, preserve those protections. We don't want to allow hate speech. We don't want mob mentality to go after individuals based on their religion. But, you know, I think for those of you who are homemakers, God bless you for that. 1-877-DALIAH.
Considered by most, optimized curcumin is one of the few bioavailable and highly absorbable curcumin products on the market. Hi, I'm Dr. Mitch. Since most chronic diseases have inflammation, our optimized curcumin seems to be a perfect addition to any nutritional program. It makes sense to me that preventing or reducing inflammation is a key component to our overall health. The Mayo Clinic found that curcumin can decrease swelling and inflammation, has antioxidant properties, and research suggests that curcumin can prevent cancer, or at least slow the spread of cancer, and in many instances make chemotherapy more effective. It protects our healthy cells even from radiation. TotalWellness.com, where we help you to look good, feel good, and enjoy total wellness.
Self-reliance. It's not a phrase we hear much in our culture these days. It might conjure up images of pioneers, the West, rifles, strapping men, and strong women. But what does it mean for us in today's world? The New American Magazine has just released its latest collector's edition, Self-Reliance, Foundation of Freedom. In it, the New American authors outline the necessity of self-reliance for a free people, tips for self-reliant living, and the importance of not giving up hope. This unique edition includes articles on the self-sufficiency of the founders, preparing for a worst-case scenario, firearms, financial self-reliance, the importance of community, and many other topics by expert writers. Now, for a limited time, the New American is offering a bundle of three collector's editions, Self-Reliance, The Great Reset, and Trump World, for just $19.95. Available at shopjbs.org. Visit shopjbs.org today.
All right, we are back on the Dr. Daliah Show. Thank you all for tuning in. 1-877-DALIAH, 1-877-DOCDALI. So this is fascinating to me. Electric vehicles are now being used by more and more people. There have been record sales of electric vehicles, even though overall it's been slowing down because those who really want one or had the money to get one got one. And the average person who can't afford one still waiting and holding out because some of us are still paying on our current cars. But an interesting side effect to electric vehicles has been reported, and it's motion sickness. And we are hearing that drivers and passengers are getting motion sick in their cars. Now, I'm a little confused by that because if you drove with me, I mean, where I start, stop, shift, I would think you'd get sick in any car where the driver is like, oh, let me switch lanes. Let me swerve here. Let me swerve here. But no, they're saying that because of the way electric vehicles accelerate, you don't brake an electric vehicle. You just take your foot off the gas. Kind of like when you jet ski, or you don't necessarily have to use brakes. You just not use the gas. And so they're saying that that is causing some people to get motion sick. So this is being reported by ABC News. They say more Americans are swapping their gas-powered cars and trucks for EVs, but they are getting sick. John Volker, a former editor of Green Car Reports and editor of Car and Driver, said strong regenerative braking, which recaptures max energy, can cause motion sickness. There's a learning curve to lifting off the accelerator in an EV. You have to modulate it. And if you are riding in the back seat of a Tesla, you'll feel it more. They say the drivers don't know how to modulate their strong regenerative braking. He said, I was thrown around a bit. And they said Teslas appear to be the worst offenders because they could be very jerky and really abrupt. According to this on ABC News, they say most automakers have termed the throttles to be jumpy in EVs to emphasize the power. But the side effect is that they could lurch and make some occupants car sick. You have to be so careful on how to apply the throttle. If not, it could lead to an abrupt seesaw motion for passengers. And so EV motion sickness is a thing. They say EVs have so much torque, you tap the throttle and the thing just takes off. The abruptness of power delivery can be unsettling to some. Okay, it's not like you're doing 4Gs. I mean, I've driven an EV. It's cool. I'm not ready to buy one. I don't have the money for it. I just don't have the patience right now to have to always charge. I could barely keep my iPhone charged. So, and I'm still paying off my car. So I love my Corvette. Let me just deal with that. I'll eventually get an electric vehicle. But I didn't feel sick because, and I've driven in them. I felt fine because the driver was already used to how they handle it. So it you will jerk a little bit, and it's just going to be early on. But motion sickness is a thing. And motion sickness is something that I struggle with on boats. I remember we were fishing for barracuda, and I actually caught the big fish of the day, but I did it while vomiting over the side. I was so seasick, but I wasn't going to stop. My husband was like, do you want to lie down? You never, by the way, when you get seasick, you don't want to go into the galley or go, you know, and you want to be outside. You want fresh air. You want to look at the horizon and stare at that. Because what you see and what your inner ear is sensing have to be in sync. If not, you start feeling sick. And your vestibular system, there it's a lot more complex than that. But roughly, your eyes and ears have to match up. And your inner ears can kind of feel the swain. And so for me, if I'm in control of the boat, like if I'm driving a boat, I'm fine. But if I'm riding and I can't control the boat, I'll start feeling sick. Well, you can't always control a fishing boat. I mean, they don't let you. I mean, you try, but yeah. So with motion sickness, the best thing to do is to, one, stay outside, you know, look at the horizon. If you're in a car, open the window, get some fresh air. Stagnant air doesn't help. I like sipping on some carbonated beverages. And, you know, you throw up. It's fascinating how your body reacts. Because as a human being, you are designed to walk on land. You're not designed to be in an airplane. You're not designed necessarily to be in an ocean. You might swim. If you go back to caveman days, you know, you were on land. You're a land animal. We might swim. We might pick up fishies. We might scuba dive. But we were never designed to be out in the middle of the ocean. Our bodies can handle beach. But when you're there, our bodies aren't designed for that. Now we've evolved to have ships. We've evolved to have boats. We've evolved to have jet skis, planes, other things, cars. Now we have electric vehicles, but it doesn't mean the body is used to that. You know, same thing with jet lag. People complain that they have jet lag and they go, something's wrong with me because I'm always jet lagged and it takes me forever to adapt. No, there's nothing wrong with you. If you have jet lag, you're normal. If I go to New York, which I'm going to do in a couple weeks, all right, it's a different time zone, 3 hours difference. the light is going to be looking differently. The sunrise, sunset's going to be different. Well, before cars and caveman days, I would have had to walk to that time zone. And by the time it took me to walk from Las Vegas, Nevada to New York, I probably would acclimate. But we're not walking from Las Vegas to New York. I'm taking a 4.5 hour flight. So yes, I'm not going to adjust. From there, I am going to be making a stop in Europe for a little bit. I'm going to be completely jet lagged. You cannot be 9 hours difference and not expect there to be it. But if I actually worked my way towards that in the olden days, I would have acclimated. Same thing with altitude sickness. You know, by the time you walk up that, by the time you get to Denver, right, or Castle Rock from Colorado Springs, you would have acclimated. But if you're driving at 75 miles an hour, no, you're not going to acclimate. So with electric vehicles, it's interesting. There's, you know, the reason why there's so much criticism of them and all this bad publicity is because of these ridiculous mandates that have been suggested. If we got rid of the mandates, the electric vehicle is pretty damn cool. It's a cool concept, and I think it is going to take. I've driven in one. It's amazing. I don't think it's realistic and practical for everybody. If you're still paying on your car and you don't think you're going to get a good trade-in value and you think these cars are overpriced, these electric vehicle cars are overpriced and the prices are going to go down, and so now you're going to be stuck paying on something that's not worth because the blue book value really dropped. No, you don't push it. If you don't have access in your apartment to an outlet to charge your car every night, there should be no stress. There's a lot of stress. There's a lot of anxiety. And then people say when they drive it, they have anxiety about their range. Well, of course, if you have an electric vehicle in the cold or in the heat, you know, and I like my iPhone acts like I have how many hours left and then I don't, or my laptop's notorious for that. It makes it seem like I have 4 hours and then 30 minutes later it shuts down. So yeah, we have battery anxiety because we're surrounded by batteries. It's going to be anxiety producing. So just don't force it. Everything needs to be a choice. If you really want the electric vehicle to be the car of the future, all right, let people evolve, get electricity, let apartment complexes figure out how to deal with it, let people see the price differences, maybe do trials, let people try one out for a week or two. Once you try an electric vehicle, you like it. But if you can't charge it, or it's cold, or you live in Buffalo and you're like, okay, this isn't going to work, then people know. But right now, to give up your car, to take a brand new car that's very, very expensive and hope to like it, America's not ready for that. So whether you get motion sick or not, remember, it's a little different mechanism. It's going to be jerky at first. All right, 1-877-DOC-DOLLY, don't go away.
Did you know that healthy arteries make a gas? Yes, actually, three known gases. Hi, I'm Dr. Mitch, and nitric oxide is a gas that's readily made all day long to keep our arteries open by relaxing the blood vessel walls. By doing this, our circulation is increased, bringing blood, oxygen, and nutrients to every part of your body. Both age and poor diet can lead to a loss of this precious gas, and in turn, blood pressure can go up, energy can go down, and you can get tingling in your hands and feet. Well, our product, Ultimate Nitric Oxide, can easily help fix this lack of nitric oxide. Go to TotalWellness.com. That's TotalWellness.com, where we are helping you to look good, feel good, and enjoy total wellness.